Okay, narito po, in-announce na ang pagdating ng Pangulong Gloria Macapagal Arroyo. Papasok na siya sa session hall ng Kongreso.
Napakalakas ng palakpakan, Cathy, dito sa session hall at halos hindi tayo magkarinigan dito.
Well, the President is making her way towards the center aisle of the session hall here. Of course, she is being ushered by a welcome committee here composed of the senators and congressmen. Nakikita natin na kinakamayan siya ng mga mambabatas na gathered ngayon dito. She is being guided towards the rostrum where she will be met by Speaker Jose de Venecia and Senate President Franklin Villon. The reception is quite very warm, Professor.
Yeah. We're hearing rhythmic clapping from the floor to the third gallery. This is probably one of the, if not the most enthusiastic welcome we've had for any chief executive.
And they are not only clapping their hands, they're also cheering for the President. Yeah.
This sort of reception should make the President feel very well.
Yes,
very well,
right.
This afternoon.
This should really make her feel very good. Sa kanyang pag-uulat sa bayan, inaasahan natin na hihilingin niya ang tulong ng mga miyembro ng Kamara at Senado upang maipagpatuloy niya ang mga programa at proyekto doon na nakapaloob sa kanyang 10-point agenda. Earlier this morning, narinig din natin si Speaker Jose de Venecia ng House of Representatives na nanawagan sa kanyang mga kasapi dito sa Kongreso na tulungan ng Pangulo sa kanyang 10-point legacy program at yung 12-point wealth creation program.
Yeah, I think the crowd is booing the Senate President.
Yes, that's right.
So, parang UAAP championship ito. There's a lot of cheering going on in the background, and I think we're ready to start now.
Yes, we're now turning over to the program proper.
The joint session is hereby called to order.
On the part of the House of Representatives, the joint session is called to order. Please remain standing for the singing of the Philippine National Anthem. Please remain standing for the nation's prayer.
Panginoong lumikha, akayin mo po ang aming lahi. Panginoong lumikha, akayin mo po ang buong bayan. Bathalang kabunyan, gabayan mo po ang Pilipino ngayon at magpakawalang hanggan. Panginoong Ama ng lahat, basbasan mo po ng kabanalan ng Pilipino. Padilisayin mo po ang katawan ng lahi, na iisa ang pangarap, iisa ang tadhana, para sa inang lupa, para sa kalwalhatian mo. Panginoong may kapal, pagbuklurin mo po ang aming bayan sa diwa ng pagkakaisa, sa diwa ng kapatiran, sa diwa ng kalinga at pag-ibig, sa ngalan mo, siya nawa.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, the distinguished members of the Congress of the Philippines, Her Excellency Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, the President of the Republic of the Philippines.
Thank you. Thank you, Speaker De Venecia. Vice President De Castro, President Ramos, Senate President Drilon, and the members of the Senate, members of the House of Representatives, Chief Justice Davide, and the members of the Judiciary, Archbishop Franco, and the Excellencies of the Diplomatic Corps, fellow government workers, whether elected, appointed, or civil servants, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Every year, we meet on this day, in this great hall, to celebrate democracy and take stock of the nation, the country and its condition, the government and its performance, the people and their well-being. Ours is a country divided. The story of our nation is a tale of two Philippines, almost as it were, two countries under the same name. One is the Philippines whose economy, after long years of cumulative national endeavor, is now poised for takeoff. The other is the Philippine whose political system, after equally long years of degeneration, has become a hindrance to progress. As a country on the verge of takeoff, our storyline would surprise many at home and abroad. The story includes an economy that grew more than 6% last year and that has continued to work in the teeth of the biggest oil price hikes in history while generating 4 million jobs in the last 4 years. The story includes marked improvements in tax collections, infrastructure, housing construction, shelter security for the urban poor and indigenous peoples, and rise productivity. The story includes 69 million beneficiaries of healthcare insurance, including 30 million indigents, whose re-enrollment started early this year and is still ongoing. That same story, over 4 years, saw the drug menace cut in half. The rash of kidnappings become a thing of the past, and the insurgency in the South abated. This story should work itself out as one about an economy as resilient and full of potential as its people are patient and hardworking, guided by a government, executive and legislative hand in hand, that's able to pass a no-nonsense budget and make the tough decisions to put our fiscal house in order. I especially refer to our recent titanic struggle to enact the three laws that comprise the biggest fiscal package in our history, the biggest revenue increase in a generation. That will break the vicious cycle of financing development by borrowing and having to borrow again just to service those loans. This is the one reform that will snap the chain that has bound our future to a profligate past and a debt-burdened present. The Filipinos' strong sense of family has given Congress a stronger resolve not to pass on today's debt and bankrupt our children and grandchildren tomorrow. That struggle has done the House and the Senate great honor. Congratulations to you. Abroad, the story continues. We've worked long and hard to restore our country to the prominent place it once held as co-founder of the United Nations and the free world's first line of defense in the East. We won a seat in the UN Security Council, where we presided over the landmark resolution calling for democracy in Iraq. The Philippines chaired a historic conference on interfaith cooperation for peace at the UN, the fruit of a bold and creative initiative by your Speaker of the House. We head the APEC Anti-Terrorism Task Force. Our victories in the war on terror have been acknowledged by no less than President Bush before the U.S. National Defense University. The Jemaah Islamiyah and the Abu Sayyaf can only pick up the pieces of their broken backbone in Mindanao. We've worked with the Organization of the Islamic Conference to forge peace with our Muslim brothers. 80% of our peace talks with them have been completed. Permanent peace in Mindanao is within reach. indeed, our story as a country on the verge of takeoff is real. Analysts need only to look at our stock market and even the peso-dollar exchange rate to sense the strong anticipation of significant improvements if only we would overcome the tendency to be our own worst enemy. Thus, with investors both here and abroad in mind, I invite you all to join me in sending them a strong message from this great hall. We will not waver in our commitment to economic reform and fiscal discipline, whatever the political cost. The other message to send is that we will address the burden that the other Philippine story imposes on our anticipated takeoff. I refer to the story of how our political system has now become a hindrance to our national progress. Over the years, our political system has degenerated to the extent that it's difficult for anyone to make any headway, yet keep his hands clean. To be sure, the system is still capable of achieving great reforms. But by and large, our political system has betrayed its promise to each new generation of Filipinos, not a few of whom are voting with their feet, going abroad, and leaving that system behind. Perhaps we politicians have done our best, but maybe our best is not enough given the present system. Perhaps we have strained the present political system to its final limit. It's time to turn to the people, bring them into government, and change the way that government is done. The people want government that works for them at every level. They want good government that begins at their doorstep in the barangay and does not end before the closed door of a bureaucrat in Metro Manila. The system clearly needs fundamental change, and the sooner, the better. It's time to start the great debate on charter change. We must address such questions as, how much more government is needed for the greater safety and economic security of our people, and how much less government is more conducive to free enterprise and economic progress. The mode of charter change is the exclusive prerogative of Congress, but a constituent assembly may well give our people the quickest reforms. I shall work with Congress. I shall work with Congress, civil society groups, and local government executives who are convinced that charter changes are needed to enable the country to surmount the unprecedented challenges of the 21st century. I take this opportunity to acknowledge the local government executives who have brought about an LGU power revolution through transformative leadership. The economic progress and social stability of the provinces, along with the increasing self-reliance and efficiency of political developments and public services there, make a compelling case for federalism. Perhaps it's time to take the power from the center to the countryside that feeds it. I recognize that our form of government will be the decision of the body constituted to undertake charter change. But we should consider that legislation could be quickened and laws made more responsive to the people under a parliamentary system similar to that similar to that of our progressive neighbors in the region. But even as we make a serious start in charter change, I hope we can still work together on other initiatives to the lasting benefit of our people. In the area of education, we've spent our increased resources on better trained teachers in more classrooms, teaching students in more effective ways. We've laid a strong foundation by building almost 30,000 classrooms in the past 4 years, providing computer access to more than 3,000 high schools, and beginning a Healthy Start breakfast program for our young school children. I ask Congress to pass the pre-need code to rehabilitate, reform, and regulate the pre-need educational programs that worked so well in the past as a major vehicle for youth education entitlement. College education is the great Filipino dream. But in the world of rapid technological change, getting a job or keeping it depends as much on how well one reasons as how well one uses his hands. I've issued EO 358 so that hours spent in vocational training can be credited towards a college degree. I call on Congress to pass legislation encouraging renewable and indigenous energy. In the area of national security, I urge the swift passage of an anti-terrorism law that will protect rather than subvert, enhance rather than weaken the rights and liberties that terrorism precisely threatens with extinction. These examples serve to highlight that there is much work to be done. Now is not the time for divisiveness. And while there's no avoiding partisan politics, there can be a determined effort by all sides to limit the collateral damage on a country poised for takeoff. Let's call on the Lord to lead us. Let us ask Him for the grace to make us worthy of His healing our land. Alam kong tayong lahat ay naghahangad na isa makabuluhang pagbabago para sa ating bayan. Tayong lahat ay nagsisikap para matamo ang kapayapaan at kaunlaran kung kaya't ako'y nakikiusap na tulungan ninyo ako para sa kapakanan ng ating bayan. We may disagree among ourselves, but let us never lose sight of that greater battle for one people, one country, one Philippines. Not the country of this or that president, but the Philippines of our shared and passionate affections. Maraming salamat sa inyong lahat. Thank you.
Natapos na po ang State of the Nation address ng ating Pangulong Gloria Macapagal-Arroyo. She is now, she can see, you're watching live pictures of the President shaking the hands of Senate President Franklin Dilon and House Speaker Jose De Vanessa. As you can see, you know, just a while ago, Professor
Senate,
Alex, talaga,
the joint session is adjourned.
On the part of the House of Representatives, the joint session is adjourned.
The shortest State of the Nation address. I was looking at the digital clock here at the House. She started exactly at 4:01 and ended exactly at 4:28.
So that's roughly about 23 minutes. Clapping, yeah. Yes, 23 minutes State of the Nation address, the shortest probably of President Gloria Macapagal-Arroyo. Sir, your thoughts on the State of the Nation address of the President this afternoon?
Well, as we anticipated, she was delivering a basic theme. This is a country that is capable of working, but it is ruined by a probably underdeveloped political system and really backward political institutions. And we need to cure that if we want to move forward. Our economy has really great potential. And we see that in the basic numbers that we have. In spite of the oil price shocks, we've managed to hold inflation under control. We've managed to post a growth rate that was unmatched in the past 15 years, 6.1%. There's high expectation of business booming, and we see that in the stock market. So despite a bigger oil bill, we've actually increased our foreign reserves to its historic highs, actually, of $17 billion, which is fairly impressive. So I think the whole speech was based on the basic outline of what works and what does not. What works is our economy and our people. What does not is the sphere of politics.
I would also like to think, Professor, that the President focused more on the positive than the negative things that are happening around us. Yeah. She made no mention of the impeachment process or of the street protests that are happening right now. But one thing that struck us here is the fact that the President mentioned about the two Philippines. Mm-hmm. Ito yung isang bansa na that is ready to take off.
Yeah.
And the other one that is just that is relatively satisfied to just stay where it is right now.
Well, siguro pwede natin sabihin na may Pilipinas na panalo, may Pilipinas na talunan. And this is a speech intended for people who are hopeful about our future, who are confident in our capacity to build that future and to reach it, and to confident in our ability to lead our nation towards that future.
Do you think that the President gave an accurate perception of the true state of the nation, Professor?
Well, in this state of the nation, she did not give fighting targets. She listed what has been done, what she has done in particular, including an executive order that allows technical school credits to be carried into the tertiary collegiate level. So these are things that have been done, and she leaves Congress with that agenda. Do you have the political will and the constituency to cause a change in our institutions and prepare them for the 21st century?
Very well said, Professor. Sa puntong ito, balikan po natin ang ating kasonang Veronica Baluyot Jimenez. Nandoon pa rin siya sa North Wing Lobby ng Batasan.